Hi everyone, this is Christina with the long overdue second part for the rock generator in Blender. It's been a while since I posted this video and some things have changed. Today we will look at the modifiers that are used in the rock generator, which in general are subdivision modifiers as well as numerous displacement modifiers, and some of the rock presets also have the smooth modifier. But just to make that clear from the start so you aren't disappointed after watching this video, this is not an in-depth tutorial for the displacement modifier. We will look at the settings in general, how they work together, but I will not go in depth. There are really good videos on YouTube where you can learn about this, especially when it comes to displacement textures. We will go briefly over that. This video will be more than long enough without going in depth, just to make that clear. Today is the 19th January 2020. We are still on final release 2.8.1. Blender 2.8.2 is now in beta, and I've downloaded the version from last night, but didn't open it up yet. To show you how you can merge folders for the add-ons, because the place where you find the rock generator has changed. In this video, I've already edited the description 4 weeks back. A viewer asked, I'm not seeing this add-on in my version of Blender 2.8.2 alpha. Did they remove it again? That was the reason I contacted the Blender devs and asked, hey guys, what happened to the rock generator? Brendan Murphy was the one answering me right away, and he told me, hey, I've merged them to the extra mesh objects, which is great news because those are part of the community tab, and that means when Blender 2.8.2 will be released mid of February, at least that's the plan for now, then we don't have to copy that add-on from an alpha version that will be in the official community tab. Brendan, if you see this, thank you very much for all that work you did and are still doing, and sorry for me not getting back to you for weeks now. That had personal reasons. I will explain that in our next chat, I hope sometimes in the following week, just so you know. I didn't forget about what you asked. Okay, but that also means now that it is merged with the extra objects, what I told you where to find it and how to copy it isn't correct anymore. That isn't a separate add-on anymore. Here I have described how to do that, and also that you might have to do a backup of the extra mesh add-on. Another viewer, Logan Wagner here, made a great suggestion because the rock generator still has its separate folder inside of the mesh extra objects, so you can grab just that single folder and copy it to the add-ons contrib like I described in the first video. It is a great suggestion, but I still recommend to grab the whole extra mesh folder. We will see why. This is my version folder for the downloads. It looks quite chaotic, but I know what's going on. And here you can see the one from the previous day and the one from last night. In this one I already worked, in this one not. I've both opened up in separate windows. This is the version from the 18th where I've worked in, and this is the blank version, just unzipped it. And when we go into this folder here, you can see there is no config folder. So the first thing I do, I will copy this and paste it into here. I always do that so I don't have to repeat the settings, the layout of my Blender and so on. And here I also have add-ons, and the extra meshes are under add-ons, not under add-ons contrib. Here you have them. That is that folder here. And if we compare those two, for example, you can see Edgeflow, Extreme PBR, they aren't in here. Those are only the add-ons that come with Blender. I want to have all the add-ons I'm daily working with in there. So what I also do, and that works on Windows 8 and 10. If you have Mac or Linux or any other older Windows version, I don't know how that is, but I would suggest grab this folder, copy it and save it under any other folder. Don't keep it in here or Blender will read it twice and that will lead to errors. So take that out of here and then just copy the new one to here. because when we go into there, you see that AddMesh Rocks folder, that is the rocks generator. But you can also see a lot of other files. And what you see here, for example, this object wasn't touched since 20th December. Other ones have really a new date. Sometimes they work on those add-ons in Prove-It, and if you only grab this one here, then you don't get the new stuff from all the other extra objects. And there are great ones in there, so maybe grab the whole folder. What I will do here, I copy this whole folder here to here, and here is already one. And in Windows, I'm now asked some questions. Do you still want to merge the folder from the old version to the new? I say yes. It takes a moment, another replacement message pops up. I say do this for all the current items and click yes. And now it will take a moment. I will speed this up till we see that other message. And here we have that message. It tells me in that add-on folder there are 1558 files with the same names. I don't replace them. I tick this one here. Let me decide for each file. Of course, I do not go through all of them separately. That would be tedious. But just to compare this one, it is the same size, but that doesn't mean it is exactly the same version. And you see here are some with newer version dates. And that might be, although they have the same size, there had been work done in them. And of course, I want to get the newer ones. And here you see skip 1343 files with the same date and size. So those one I skip. But here we still have that other message. And you can see over 200 files have another size or date. And I will keep those ones here. I will tick this and I will skip them and say continue. And then it only copies those 200 and a few files to my add-ons folder. And now I have the same add-ons here in the new version. This is the one I didn't start, but I did copy the config folder. So if I start this now, I'm not asked the initial setup. I immediately get this screen here where I see the last used files and so on. And this is Blender 2.82 beta, the beta from last night. And if you use that version, you don't have to copy anything. We go to Edit, Preferences. And in my version here, that is already active because I have those add-ons active all the time and you've seen me copying them. But you just type in extra and here you have that AddMesh extra objects. That is the one where the rock generator is now included. And while you are here, maybe also grab another one. That is the modifier tools add-on. That is really helpful. I will show this in this video. Just activate that. That ships with Blender. You don't have to install anything. Let's have a look at that new rock generator. It is still under AddMesh. Here you find it. I prefer the shortcut Shift-A and grab it here. The panel is still the same. The changes Brandon did are under the hood. For the settings I warned you about, he tweaked them a little bit so we don't have immediately crashes when we tweak the settings too high. What I did forget to ask, and if I remember it, I will ask him in our next chat, hopefully this week. Those here. I really did forget to ask why there are two scale values, and like I said in the first video, I have no clue why that is the case. Maybe Brandon doesn't know that either. He isn't the original author, but I guess if somebody knows what's that about, it is him. So most likely in 2 or 3 weeks when you watch this video, in the description you will find an edit section. There's either written, I still have no clue if Brandon doesn't know about that, or I try to describe only with words what's that about, but we already know I'm really bad at that. So most likely you might find a link to another video where I explain why there are two scale values. We will not go through the settings again. We did this in the last video. We will have a look at the modifiers, but I don't keep the default preset. First, I will generate an asteroid. And yeah, looks fancy. Let's keep this. I grab it and pull it to the side. And a little bit above, floating in the air, but that's okay. I just want to make place for a second one with a preset I really like and use often. the sandstone preset, because that also has the smooth modifier. That is that one who has those nice ripples. Let's keep this one. And I also grab this one and pull it above the ground plane. Before we go into the modifiers here with this one, you can see those jagged lines. You might think, well, I crank up the subdivision modifiers. There are two of them, and we will have a look why there are two of them. Don't do that. Most often, even with a really high subdivision, you don't get rid of those artifacts. I believe I mentioned that in the first video, but anyway, I tell you in this. So if I did forget that in the first, you now know it. You go to this icon here. Those are the object data properties. And here you have that section normals. Auto smooth is checked by default if you use the rock generator, not in general, but if you use the add-on. And if I now increase this angle, watch what happens to those artifacts. The higher I push that value, the more of them go away, and most likely you don't have to go over 80 or 90, but you can push that up to 180 if you need to. Maybe let's push that up a little bit higher, and that looks fine. Now let's go to the modifiers tab, and that add-on I just recommend, the modifier tools. Those are those four buttons here. What are they for? I started using this add-on because of this here. When I do client work, I export everything in OBJ, Collada, FBX, or whatever format my client needs. When you have those modifiers on, there is a real object generated in the export, but if you use creases or sharp edges, sometimes that result doesn't look exactly like the object with the modifiers. So in general, it is a good idea to make a copy of the original with the modifiers, and on the copy I apply the modifiers. And you always should do this from top to bottom. But I work with add-ons like Fluent, Speedflow, HardOps, Boxcutter, and other ones which generate really a lot of modifiers. I don't want to go through 20, 30 or even more modifiers and always click apply. Go to the next one, apply. With this add-on here, I can apply them all at once, and this add-on automatically takes the right order from top to bottom. But there are other advantages, like this one. You can see here all modifiers are expanded, which is kind of confusing. If you click this here, toggle stack, they are all closed, and then I can go into the one I need and just open it. And you can also expand them all again. And another nice option is this here. When I tick this, that is the same as if I deactivate those display icons here. Then we will see our real object. And you can see those are only a few faces, mostly triangles. Sometimes you also find quads in there, and they are often distorted. Not planar anymore, but because of the subdivision surface that still works. So that's how this object here looks. And for this one, that is even simpler. That often just is a cube where one side is cut off. And everything else comes from our modifiers, so that it looks like this. I toggle the stack for this one here. It is already toggled. Let's toggle it here too. Here you can see this is the sandstone preset. We have two subserves for displacement, and those are in every preset which is in the add-on. But this one has the smooth. In addition, this one doesn't. Sometimes you see modifiers red. If you see something red in a modifier, that means there is a setting missing. This modifier doesn't work at all. If I go again into the rock generator, and now we have this in addition here, and I keep it there for the moment. I believe I mentioned that in the last video. If you pull the roughness down, which I usually do with the sandstone, if I pull this down and toggle the stack for this one, you can see displacement 2 and 3, that comes from the numbers. In fact, those are the third and the fourth. They are red. They are used for the roughness of the surface. Here, when I deactivate those two, that isn't what we expect from an asteroid. So here I need them in the sandstone preset. I most often just deactivate them, or deactivate the roughness by setting it to 0, and then you can go in and delete those two. You don't need them. They don't contribute to the shape of our object. Let me grab this one here and pull it, pull it to the side. And if we compare those two, you can see those jagged lines here, those artifacts. And for that, you don't get rid of with that autosmooth trick. It gets a bit better, but you can even push that up to the highest value of 180, and they don't all go away. In general, I UV those rocks and put on sandstone textures, and I use the normals, so I don't need the roughness on the surface. And if I go into the modifiers and deactivate those two, there are quite some changes on the surface, but still I prefer this without those two modifiers here. So I also delete them. Those were the two that were red, and the other one where I set the roughness to 0 from the start. This first displacement here, if I deactivate that, you see minor changes, but they are almost not visible. And that's almost always the case. Even in this one here, we see the size, this orange outline is changing a little bit. But if you like your object in general like it is, just delete it. Blender doesn't have to calculate something that brings in so minor changes like this one. This is always set to very low strength. If we go in here, we see that here. If I increase the strength, that really makes a difference. But when you in general like your object, almost always you can deactivate this or delete it. So I delete this also. Before we have a look in the other displacements, let's talk about the two subsurfs. Here in the modifier, the official name is subdivision surface. Subsurf is just another term. Here we have the smooth modifier, which has an option for vertex groups. We will look into that later, as well as for the displacement. And then it makes sense if I use vertex groups to have two modifiers from the same kind with different settings. But the subsurf doesn't work with vertex groups. So what's that about? Why do we have two and they have exactly the same settings? You can see that here both are on Catmull-Clark, both are on viewport 3. All the other settings, everything is the same. And if you keep it that way and don't need higher subdivisions than 6, because 6 is here the largest number you can get. If you need 8 subdivisions, you will need a second one with 2. But in most cases, we don't need such a high subdivision that generates a ridiculous amount of faces. So in this case, I could delete this one and just set the viewport and the render subdivisions higher. So why are there two of them? Well, first of all, maybe you want to use the Catmull-Clark in one of them and in the other one, the Simple. If I tick that, that changes dramatically. And to show you what really happens under the hood here, I grab our good old default cube and activate the wireframe in the viewport so we can see what's happening. If I throw on a subdiv here, you can immediately see this is rounded out. Let's grab this to the side so that isn't in our rock there. The higher I set this, the more subdivisions I get and the more it is rounded. And that is because of this Catmull-Clark setting. If I tick the Simple setting, the original edges are kept sharp. They aren't rounded like those here, but we still have the subdivisions. You can see that here. The subdivisions stay, but the edges that are really in the object are now not rounded anymore. So that's the difference between Catmull-Clark and Simple. And here in this one, if I do it on the first one, that looks quite fancy. Most often I would use it this way. I set this one to Catmull-Clark and this one to Simple. so I only have the subdivisions but not the object rounded out more. That could be one reason you use two subdivision modifiers. Here we have another setting. In most of the objects you won't see a difference at all. If you change this from sharp to smooth, and smooth keep corners is the default. This is only about the display, so that doesn't make a difference either, but this one can make a huge difference. Use creases. With creases, you can keep the edges sharp. If I, for example, go into edit mode with this one here, and I'm in edge mode, if I select all, go into item in the end panel, and set the main crease to 1, that has the same effect as if I'm using the simple option. And of course, I can do that for only a few of them. So for example, if I use this edge here and do a main crease, you can see what happens here in the object. So creases help us to keep edges sharp or only rounded a little bit. When I set this to another value here, for example, you can see how this gets rounded a little bit. So the crease helps me to do things like that. And we can also use them in objects like this. So I don't have any creases in here. Let's grab this one here, which really rounds the back of the object. And what you don't see in here are the displacement modifiers. We only see how the subsurface looks if we tick those. Also, the rest of the modifiers is shown. We still see our original object like a cage around the result. If you want to see where your vertices and edges are, also tick those here. Now I can see exactly where my edges are drawn on or pushed to on the object. So if I grab this one here and set this to crease, you can see what happens in there. And most likely we use this with a low subdivision level, something like that, and set the second one higher so we get our nice surface back. And here I don't use the crease, I uncheck this. Look what happens. If I uncheck it here, the surface changes. And that is how I use those two subdivisions, and I can only assume it, but I guess that's the reason why there are two in it. So creases are a nice option to sharpen edges without having to do holding loops, which saves us geometry. This one I will delete. I guess we don't need it anymore. Now let's have a closer look at the displacement modifiers. We already deleted the one that didn't really change a lot. If I deactivate this one, this has dramatic effect. So now most of that what we want to have in an asteroid is gone. And that is the same here. Let's toggle the stack. No, I don't want to delete them all. Wrong button. If I here deactivate the first one, that is the one that doesn't make a lot of change at all. In the other ones, I have deleted that. Let's also delete that here. If I deactivate this one, you can see how that looks. So this 001 is the one that brings the most changes, but we've already seen this. Those two contribute to the roughness of our surface, so I keep them here. Let's have a look at both of those textures in this 001. Here you can see this is named 001 also. Here is that texture tab. When I click that, here I see how that looks. And that is the Voronoi texture, which is built in. Like I said in the intro, we will not go into depth into this, but just so you know, those are built-in textures, procedural textures. Apart from this one, for this one you really need an image or a movie. But with those ones you can play around, and they sometimes change our object in a strange way. The blend is just a gradient that doesn't do a lot for this. Clouds always is a nice option that now looks much smoother. But also magic and the Musgrave, for example. This one also have nice effects. We have been on Voronoi. This one, I use that very often for sci-fi stuff. Have a look at that. Now that looks like this. And you have a lot of options to play around with the texture itself. So you can change the type of your texture. Let's go back to Voronoi. That's the one we had. If we go to this one, you can see that changes to 005 because that is the one that is used in this modifier here. You see that here? And we still have Voronoi, but it looks a lot different, not only here, but also if you look at those options here. You can see with this one, the sandstone, it is actual distance, and here we have the distance squared. So play around with those options. You can get nice results, so you can change the texture itself. Of course, you can go in here, and this one has the 005. So if I use this one, it still looks different because we also have this different setting here, actual distance and squared distance and things like that. But nice options. Let's go back to this. Okay, there are more options in the displacement. What plays a role is the direction in which the displacement works, the direction of the displacement itself. Often I keep this on normal, but there is no rule where you can say keep it on normal if you have this or change it to that. Just play around with those. Sometimes when you go to the other axis, you get nice results, different results. So play around with those. And also the texture coordinates play a role. We have a difference between local and global. We don't have UVs on our object, so that doesn't make a difference. That is the same like local at the moment. You can see that if I change to local, switch between local and UV, that doesn't make a difference. But this one here, object, I get this field. Here I can click. That is the list of my objects in my scene. And if I grab one of those are the sandstones. Look what happens to my object. This now looks weird, and that is because this displacement is set quite high. We have a strength of 0.972. If we look into this here, this is set to 0.059. So there is a huge difference in the strength, which means when you pull this down, and also maybe add a smooth modifier, which smooths out that artifacts, that's always a nice option to try out how the texture coordinates from other objects work on our rock. But let's set this back to local, and that was 974. So we kind of have our object back. And you've already seen that here, the strength, of course, plays a huge role how our object is displaced. The mid-level corresponds to the texture. If we go back to this texture, black parts are pushed in. Those are the dents in our rock. And those white lines, those are those ridges which are protruding. And the mid-level is a 50% gray. And if I change that, I can change the size of my object in general. So, but that easily distorts that when you pull that too high. In general, I don't play around with that option a lot. Most often I keep it on the mid-level here. And then we have the vertex groups. So at the moment we only see our subdivision. I've already activated this edge here, which has two vertices. Let's just grab those and make a vertex group. You do that here on that tab. Again, the object data tab. Here on top, I click this plus icon here. I don't name it now. In general, I give them names. What is important is to assign the vertices, those two vertices we see on the edge. You can always try that out. If I click deselect, the selection of this edge should go away. And I also can select it again. So those two vertices here are now in that group. And when I go back into object mode to my modifiers and check this here and then grab that group, you can see what happens. Here on the front, I don't see our displacement, and here in the back, we have it. Most likely, you would do it the other way around. Sometimes you might need in an object to do different displacements for different parts of the object, and you can do it like this. And in the smooth modifier, which we will have a look at now, you can also use them. I delete that here, so the displacement is all over our object. Let's go to that smoothing modifier. If you see this one red, do not just deactivate it. Sometimes the axes aren't checked. If I deactivate them all, you see this is now red. So don't delete that immediately. In general, you need it for things like that. I always check all axes and then just try out what fits best. Sometimes you don't need one of them. Sometimes I uncheck the Z axis, but in general, I keep them all three checked. We have that factor here, and yes, that just means how strong the smoothing works. But be careful, we could assume the higher the value, the more it is smoothed, but that's not really true with this one. Look what happens. So if I really pull that high, that's not what we want. You can do weird things. When you do sci-fi stuff, you might use it with values like this, but in general, the value that is drawn in the rock generator is a good value. Still, I often try what happens when I change it between 1 and 2. Just try to find a setting that works good. And the repeat, yes, that is just repeating the iterations here. So if I pull that down to 1, you can see that is not as smooth. Most often I keep it with 2 or 3. That depends on the object. And here you can also see that field for the vertex group, and that works the same. You can see now it gets rough here. And if we have, a look at the back, where that vertex is in that group, here it is smooth. So you can separate parts and to do different groups here. That's a nice option. And that's it about the modifiers. There will be a third video where we will briefly go over how to texture those rocks when we don't have UVs. I most often UV those objects. People say I'm weird in some regards. Yes, I am. I enjoy UV editing. I enjoy retopo or remeshing in general. And that are topics most artists don't like at all. But I know some people that also have written, hey, I enjoy that too. I love it. Yes, so I most often UV edit all my objects. I even do that for other artists. But you don't need UVs on your rocks. But that is a whole other topic we will go to through another video. If you have questions about this, of course, like always, ask in the comments. But please don't be mad at me if I don't answer your question, just writing down what you want to know. This is a topic where explaining only with words most often doesn't work at all, and I'm bad at it. So you might get an answer, hey, here's a video which will be timestamped. If I can find one that answers your question. You know, normally I answer with words, but yeah, sometimes you just have to refer to other people's videos. Anyway, before I forget that, this video is the first one where I used that intro in. That is an intro that was done by my friend Javas Lewis. Thank you so much, Jay. I really love it. And I will link to the stream where he did that live for me in the description below. So if you want to know how such a BTracer animation is done. And BTracer is a Blender add-on that is free. It ships with Blender. Just try it out. This is awesome stuff. Thank you very much, Jay. But now, thank you all for watching. If you like my contents, please consider subscribing to my channel. If you already did, thank you very much. Hopefully see you in the next video. Till then, have a great time. Happy plundering. Bye bye.